Hello and welcome to Film Companion South. In this episode of Flashback, we are going to be talking about a blockbuster Telugu movie from 1980, K. Viswanath's Sankarabharanam, which is available on Amazon Prime with subtitles. As always, with the Flashback series, there are going to be major spoilers ahead, so please try to watch the movie before you watch this. Now, on to the movie. This is the story of a famous Carnatic vocalist named Shankara Shastri and played by Somayajulu. It is also a story about music itself. We hear songs not just from the composer K.V. Mahadevan and the lyricist Veturi Sundaramurthy, but also from famous Carnatic composers like Bhadrachala Ramdas, Tyagaraja and Mysore Vasudevachar. The sense of music starts right at the beginning when we hear musical sounds being created by the passengers on a boat. And the man who represents his music, the maestro Shankara Shastri, is mythologized. When a child, a little boy played by the actress Tulasi, enters this man's house, every part of the house resonates with music. And even while sleeping, Shankara Shastri can pick up a song just like that from where the child forgets the song.
Shri Ramani Kucha Durga Vihari.
His domestic help says that when he's on stage, he's like a sage in penance. And she gives this little anecdote about how he wouldn't come off stage even when his wife was pregnant and about to deliver their child. By the time he finished and came back home, the wife was dead. A lot of the time, this is the kind of movie Sankarabharanam is. Simple, it's direct, a lot of the stuff is conveyed through dialogue, but what makes the movie unique is the emotional connect. And this is where we get the other major character of the movie, Tulasi, played by Manju Bhargavi. She's a dasi, a superb dancer, and she worships Shankara Shastri because he represents all that is pure and lofty in art. Tulasi is visually linked to Shankara Shastri. Balu Mahendra is a cinematographer, and as long as Tulasi is in the vicinity of Shankara Shastri, many scenes are framed with this Tulasi plant in Shankara Shastri's house. But when Tulasi leaves Shankara Shastri, the plant too withers, it has no leaves. The most interesting thing about this relationship is that Tulasi never speaks to Shankara Shastri. We get a scene where Shankara Shastri is teaching his daughter music and Tulasi happens to come by in the background and she begins to dance, but she doesn't speak. We get the scene where Tulasi is trying to escape the man who is trying to exploit her, so she runs away and gets into the train compartment that Shankara Shastri is on and they have an encounter, but again she doesn't speak. We get the scene where Tulasi's mother catches up with her and accuses Shankara Shastri of abducting Tulasi, but again she doesn't speak. The way she communicates with him, her guru, is through the art. In this scene, she plays the LP of his music and sings along. A little into the scene, Tulasi is raped by the zamindar who has his eye on her. Now look again how she and Shankara Shastri are linked through the art. He may not be in the room, but his voice is witness to whatever is happening to her. And how does she kill the zamindar? With a piece of glass from a broken photo of Shankara Shastri. Even the one scene where she directly speaks to him, she addresses him and speaks to him, it is not to him actually, but to his poster. It is what we call the mind voice. It's not actual dialogue. Why doesn't she speak? Because she thinks of him as her guru and she doesn't think she's worthy enough to speak to him. She just wants to serve him, and this humility, this servitude is brought out through several shots of feet. After the rape, for example, Tulasi's hands are filled with the blood of the man she murdered and she comes to Shankara Shastri's house and smears the blood on his feet. After the rape, Tulasi has a son, the boy we saw earlier, the child, and she tells his boy, "I took care of you for so long just so you can serve at his feet." The boy becomes Shankara Shastri's student and he washes his master's feet. And in the end, Tulasi dies at Shankara Shastri's feet.
Amma? 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 Amma?
But Shankara Shastri has no problem speaking to Tulasi. He gives her asylum in his house, and one day when he sees his daughter fall down while doing her chores, he looks at Tulasi and says, "Why can't you do something? Can't you cook?"
Neeku vanta cheyadam chetha kada?
Tulasi is happy because he is not treating her like a dasi but like a member of his own family. She pours water on herself, in a sense she purifies herself, and she enters the kitchen and cooks. The film cuts from the cooking flame in Tulasi's hand to the aarti at the temple. The message is clear. In Shankara Shastri's mind, he doesn't care about the fact that she's been raped or that she comes from a dasi family. To him, she is pure. He tells her traditions and rituals are to keep people on the right path and not to separate them in the name of caste.
Achara vyavaharalu manasulni kramamaina margamlo pettadaniki tappa manushulni kulavane perutho vidadeyadaniki kaatulu.
Some of the other angles in Sankarabharanam are not as impressive. For example, there's this angle about how Western music is on the rise and it hits the livelihoods of people like Shankara Shastri. His concerts dry up and he's forced to borrow money.
Malli dabbu kavala?
Avunayya.
Illu taakattu pettukunna neraniki inni saarlu enta nimmantaru pantulu garu?
Worse, his neighbors, a bunch of hooligans, modify the tune of Jai Jai Shiv Shankar and tease him.
Hello Shankar Shastri, how are you? Jai Jai Shastri, nambo darana kumikara.
Shankara Shastri shuts them up by singing Western music. But he makes clear that no music is superior. He says music is divine whether it's Indian or Western.
Music is divine whether it is Western or Indian.
It's just that the cartoonish manner in which his whole episode is treated makes it very unimpressive. The sense of Carnatic music being diluted is brought out far more effectively by the character of Shankara Shastri's daughter, Sharada, played by Rajyalakshmi. Now look at the scene where the man Sharada loves comes to a house to ask for her hand. She starts by singing a pure Carnatic song. But the stanzas turn into light music. So we sense a generational change right there, but the more important generational change is the passing of Carnatic music from Shankara Shastri to Tulsi's son. Earlier we saw the scene where the boy forgot the words to the song and Shankara Shastri picked up the words. In this scene, at towards the end, Shankara Shastri is unable to sing because he's coughing and the boy picks up the words and continues the song. And we get the final moment involving feet, where Shankara Shastri passes on a recognition that he got for his singing an ankle ornament to the boy. So the ultimate point is that music is pure and it doesn't differentiate between a Vidwan and a child born of rape to a Dasi. Everyone is same in the eyes of art. So that's it for this episode of Flashback. These episodes are actually the toughest to write and edit among all the things that we do. So do spread the word and try to make them more popular. Thank you for watching Film Companion South.